Hello students, so today's lecture will be about the extrahepatic biliary apparatus. Now the biliary apparatus is all the tubular structures that are going to drain the liver, produce the bile produced by the liver from the liver into the second part of duodenum. So traditionally it is divided into intrahepatic and extrahepatic parts. In this diagram, this dotted line, this denotes the inferior border of the liver. These are the this is the right hepatic duct, this is the left hepatic duct, and these are its tributaries coming from each segment of liver. You can see that the left hepatic duct is draining segment 1, segment 2, segment 3, segment 4, basically all the segments of the left functional liver, whereas the right hepatic duct, its anterior tributary is draining the segments 5 and 8, which form the medial or the anterior sector of the right functional liver, and its posterior tributary is draining segments 6 and 7, which form the lateral or the posterior sector of the right functional liver. Plus, in addition, the posterior tributary drains bile from segment 1 also. So these are all forming the intrahepatic part of the biliary tree. Everything outside the liver that is going to carry bile towards the duodenum, or anything intervening in between, that is called as the extrahepatic biliary apparatus, abbreviated as EHBA. So what does it consist of? It does consist of these little extrahepatic parts of the left and the right hepatic ducts. Then it consists of the common hepatic duct from the union of left and right hepatic ducts up to the union of cystic duct with the common hepatic duct. Okay, so common hepatic duct is from here to here. Then it also includes the gallbladder and the duct connecting the gallbladder to the common hepatic duct, that is the cystic duct. And lastly, this common hepatic duct, distal to its union with the cystic duct, is called as the common bile duct, or sometimes just the bile duct, right? So we will be discussing these parts one by one. So first of all, the right and the left hepatic ducts. Now these emerge from the liver via the porta hepatis, we know, and they unite near the right end of the porta hepatis to form the common hepatic duct. We know that the right hepatic duct's extrahepatic part is very small and almost vertical, and that is just 0.5 to 2 centimeter in adults, whereas the left one, although they are shown to be similar in this diagram, the left one is more horizontal and its course is longer. The left hepatic duct after exiting the liver has a slightly longer course than that of the right one, that is 1.5 to 3.5 centimeters. Now they unite together to form the common hepatic duct. The common hepatic duct descends for about 3 centimeters before it is joined obliquely on its right side, mostly by the cystic duct. However, there are other configurations in which the cystic duct can join the common hepatic duct. We will talk about that later on. So the length of the common hepatic duct is almost 3 centimeters, and its luminal diameter, that is the diameter of its the passage within it which carries the bile or the lumen, that is roughly 5 millimeter as measured by ultrasonography, right? And so it is about 3 centimeter long, and the cystic duct unites with it to form the common bile duct. Where is the common hepatic duct lying? It is lying in the upper part of the right free margin of lesser omentum. We all know that the common hepatic and the common bile duct, plus the proper hepatic artery and the portal vein, these are all contents of the right free margin of the lesser omentum, right? So the common hepatic duct is lying in the upper part of that right free margin of lesser omentum. What are its relations within this right free margin of lesser omentum? To its left side obviously lies the proper hepatic artery, behind it lies the portal vein, and to its right side and slightly below it also, to the right and inferior aspect, lies obviously the cystic duct. And right hepatic artery, in most of the cases, it crosses behind the common hepatic duct because it arises from the proper hepatic artery, and proper hepatic artery is lying on the left side of the common hepatic duct. So right hepatic artery has to cross the common hepatic duct. In mostly it crosses on its posterior aspect, but it may cross on its anterior aspect as well, right? And the diameter of the lumen is about 5 millimeter. Then we come to the gallbladder. Now you have all seen the gallbladder in the D-hall. The gallbladder is a flask-shaped blind-ended diverticulum. This is the blind end of the gallbladder, and it is attached to bile duct, obviously by the cystic duct. And it is grayish blue in color in the living. In the cadavers, you have seen that it is a very darkish green in color. And it is situated obliquely in the non-peritoneal cystic fossa on inferior surface of the right hemiliver, right? This part is usually not covered by peritoneum, only this part is covered by peritoneum. And it extends from the right end of the porta hepatis, here, somewhere here. There lies the neck of the gallbladder and up to the inferior border of the liver. This is a sagittal section, a parasagittal section actually, through the middle of roughly the cystic fossa of the liver. Here you can see that it is lying between the second part of duodenum, or the junction of first and second parts of duodenum, posterior inferior to it and anterior superior to it lies the liver. So what are the dimensions of gallbladder? Normally length is roughly 7 to 10 centimeter, maximum width is 3 centimeter, and its capacity is usually at resting state it is 25 ml, and it can collect bile up to a maximum volume of 50 ml. Then what are its parts? This blind end is called as the fundus. Then this whole part is called as the body, extending from the fundus to this part which connects to the bile duct via the cystic duct, and this connecting part between the body and the cystic duct, this narrow part, is called as the neck of the gallbladder. So we have the fundus, body and the neck. Now first of all, the fundus, that is obviously the lower expanded free and blind end, and it projects beyond the inferior border of liver. In some people it does not, but mostly it does project beyond the inferior border of the liver, and it is directed downwards and forwards. You can see in this sagittal section, and it is, if we see from front, it is directed slightly to the right side as well. Like here you can see it is, this is an oblique view, again the similar sagittal section, but you can see that it is directed slightly to the right as well. And it meets the anterior abdominal wall at this acute angle of roughly 30 degrees, and the fundus is covered by peritoneum on all the aspects, because the peritoneum is coming from here, from the anterior surface of liver, goes over this and then moves on to the posterior inferior surface of the gallbladder. And what are its relation in the front? Obviously the anterior abdominal wall related to the tip of the ninth costal cartilage, and then behind is lying the transverse colon, right? So it is resting on the transverse colon close to the hepatic flexure or the right flexure of the colon. Then we come to the part of the body, a part of the gallbladder, that is the body. So body is obviously extending from fundus to the neck. It is directed upwards and backwards and to the left side, slightly towards the left side. Upper surface is normally not covered by peritoneum, only the inferior surface is covered by peritoneum. What are its relations? Above, obviously the cystic fossa of the liver, and in between the gallbladder and the cystic fossa is the loose areolar connective tissue, and within that usually lies the deep branch of cystic artery and the corresponding vein. Sometimes peritoneal covering reaches even the superior surface of the gallbladder, and in that case the gallbladder is suspended from the cystic fossa by a small mesentery. What are the relations below? Below there is the transverse colon as well as the first part. First part, actually it should be the superior duodenal flexure or the second part of duodenum that lies behind the body of the gallbladder. Might be related, if it is lying medially, then it might be related to first part, but mostly it is related to second part of the duodenum. Then on the right side, obviously what will be lying is the right colic flexure, the remaining part of right part of liver also, and plus the superior duodenal flexure also, if the body is lying in relation to first part of duodenum. And on the left side, obviously, what will be lying is the pyloric part of the stomach, right? Then we come to the neck of the gallbladder. So neck is this part, this S-shaped structure, which is connected to the bile duct, common hepatic duct actually. This is the common bile duct via the cystic duct. So the neck forms an S-shaped curve. That S-shaped curve is not quite visible in this diagram. In this one, it is better visible. So it extends from top of body to the cystic duct, right? First, it goes upward and forward, this part. It is going upward and forward, and then abruptly turns downwards and backwards. If you see here, then it goes upward and backward also, and then it turns backwards and downwards. You do not need to remember all the direction. You just should know that it is going in an S-shaped curve usually. Then it is obviously continuous with the cystic duct and usually separated on the surface by a constriction. What is Hartmann's pouch? How Hartmann's pouch is a small diverticulum from the neck that sometimes projects downwards or backwards towards the duodenum. Hartmann's pouch is usually formed by impaction of something called as a gallstone here. It is normally not present and it is formed because of impaction of a gallbladder in this area, right? Then the part of the neck which gives attachment to this Hartmann's pouch is sometimes called, it is called as an isthmus, and this part itself is called as the infundibulum. Now, what are the relations of the neck? Above the neck is obviously again non-peritoneal, related to the surface of liver, and this space here contains the cystic artery. Before, it has divided into the deep and the superficial branches. The deep branch is meant for supplying the superior or the anterosuperior surface of gallbladder, which lies in contact with the liver, and the superficial branch is supposed to supply the peritoneal surface of the liver, which is covered by the peritoneum or the posterior inferior surface of the gallbladder, right? So above, the neck is non-peritoneal, related to liver, loose areolar tissue, and there is that contains the cystic artery before it divides into its branches, and the inferior surface is covered with peritoneum and is related to the first part of the duodenum. This one, in this diagram, it is more clearer. It is related to the first part of the duodenum, right? Then what is the arterial supply of gallbladder? We all know that cystic artery is usually a branch of, now see, this is the proper hepatic artery, this is the common hepatic duct, this is common bile duct, this is the cystic duct. You can see that the right hepatic artery is arising from the proper hepatic artery, this is the cystic artery arising from the right hepatic artery. That divides into a superficial and deep branches, superficial and deep branches. Here you can also see the deep and the superficial branches close to the neck of the gallbladder. Superficial branch will supply the inferior surface covered with peritoneum, deep branch will supply the superior surface not covered by the peritoneum. We will see the various variations of the cystic artery, which are very important for a surgeon to know while doing any operation in this area. The most commonly done surgical procedure in this area is a cholecystectomy, that is removal, surgical removal of the gallbladder. So for that, the surgeon must know the cystic artery, that it can arise from places other than the right hepatic artery, its relations to the common hepatic duct, to the cystic duct and common bile duct. Everything should be in the mind of the surgeon while operating in this area. Venous drainage of the gallbladder is by a cystic vein. It usually does not accompany the cystic artery back. What it does is that it usually pierces this cystic fossa to open in the intrahepatic part of the portal vein, right? Sometimes the cystic vein drains into right branch of portal vein at the porta hepatis, so it does not enter the liver sometimes. Lymphatic drainage is from the gallbladder. First of all, there is a cystic lymph node lying in this triangular region. We will be discussing what this triangular region is called as later on. So first, the lymphatics go into the cystic lymph node. From the cystic lymph node, the lymphatics travel to the hepatic lymph nodes lying here at the porta hepatis. Then the lymphatic vessels travel along the hepatic artery to the celiac lymph nodes. Or sometimes the lymphatics might enter directly into the liver, right? So different channels for lymphatic drainage are present. Then the nerve supply of gallbladder is mainly by the sympathetic nerves via the hepatic and the celiac plexuses that are lying along the origin of the celiac trunk in front of the abdominal aorta and the origin of the hepatic artery, as well as surrounding the this common and the proper hepatic arteries. A few twigs from the right phrenic nerve also reach the gallbladder through the hepatic and phrenic plexuses, carrying the postganglionic sympathetic fibers, and this is the reason why in inflammation of gallbladder, while the pain is actually happening here, the patient will feel that pain is arising in the right shoulder, because the phrenic nerve also gives sensory nerve supply. A phrenic nerve is actually not giving the nerve supply, but the skin over your shoulder receives sensory nerve supply from the same spinal segments which give rise to the phrenic nerve as well. So the brain will interpret the pain which is actually coming from here. The brain will think that the pain is coming from the shoulder region, which shares a common spinal segmental nerve supply with the gallbladder, right? Then we come to the variations. Yes, the normal one we had seen that cystic artery is arising from the right hepatic artery. Now, if we have a look at the variations, we can see that this is common bile duct, this is common hepatic duct, left and the right hepatic ducts. This is the common hepatic artery, this is gastroduodenal artery, this is hepatic artery proper. So the cystic artery here is arising from the hepatic artery proper, not from the right hepatic artery, and it is crossing the hepatic duct on its anterior aspect. Normally, it does not cross the common hepatic duct. Here, it is crossing the common hepatic duct on its anterior aspect. Another variation is that cystic artery might be arising from gastroduodenal artery, again crossing the hepatic duct over a long course and crossing on its anterior aspect, right? Then in this variation, it is again arising from the proper hepatic artery, but from a lower level as compared to in this thing. So it is crossing the front of common hepatic duct obliquely, right? Then originating from the gastroduodenal artery. Then in this one, where is it coming from? It might be coming from either the superior pancreaticoduodenal artery, which is a branch of the gastroduodenal artery, or it might come directly from the celiac artery, or it might come from the right gastric artery. So again, a very long course. Then it might come from the left hepatic artery and cross in front of the common hepatic duct to reach the gallbladder. And in these cases, you may have multiple cystic arteries. One coming from the proper hepatic artery, one coming normally from the right hepatic artery, another one arising from the right hepatic artery more distally. So a surgeon should be aware of all these variations during cholecystectomy. Why is it important? Because during cholecystectomy, what a surgeon needs to do basically is they have to ligate the cystic duct at two places. One ligature has to be placed here. Ligature is just means tying with a thread. That thread could be nylon or any that suture material. So we tie off the cystic duct at two places and cut it in between so that there is no leakage of bile either from the common hepatic duct side or from the gallbladder side before we have removed this gallbladder. Similarly, the cystic artery has to be ligated at two places and it is cut from in between those two ligatures. So it is very important to identify that what we are ligating is the cystic duct and not the common bile duct or the common hepatic duct, because we do not want to ligate this structure. If we ligate here, then the drainage of bile into the duodenum will be blocked. Similarly, while ligating the cystic artery, we need to make sure that we are ligating and cutting cystic artery, not the right hepatic artery, suppose in the normal disposition. If we are going to place a ligature here, it is chances are high that the surgeon might instead place the ligature in this part. So he will be ligating the right hepatic artery. So the blood supply to the entire right functional lobe of the liver will be lost. At least the arterial blood supply, the portal will not be lost, but we do not want that to happen. So it is very important for the surgeon to identify the cystic artery, the right hepatic artery, the common hepatic duct, and the cystic duct. First define them, and then we should, eventually place ligatures, or in this laparoscopic procedures we place metallic clips instead of ligatures. So it is very important to first identify all the structures in this region before placing those ligatures or clips. We'll come to that later on also. Then what are the anomalies of gallbladder? The gallbladder might be totally absent, that is agenesis of gallbladder. The gallbladder might be duplicated. There might be two gallbladders, each might have its own cystic duct, or the two might be connected at the neck and drain via a single cystic duct. That diagram is not shown here. Then there may be a septate gallbladder. There may be a septum within the gallbladder dividing it into two parts. There may be an intrahepatic gallbladder, which we had talked about in the demonstration on liver, where just like the pons hepatis, the bridge of hepatic tissue covering the groove for IVC, there might be a bridge of hepatic tissue covering the cystic fossa, so that the gallbladder practically lies within the liver. There may be a mobile or a floating gallbladder with a mesentery. There is a clinical importance of this thing. Although it is very rare, it is present in only roughly 4 to 5% of cases. That because it is mobile, it is very prone to torsion. It can twist around, leading to kinking or blocking of the cystic artery and the cystic vein. So the blood supply to the gallbladder will be blocked, and it might cause this avascular necrosis of the gallbladder, a serious complication. Then there is something called as a Phrygian cap. In Phrygian cap, there is nothing pathological, but what has happened is that the fundus is folded over the body. It is the fundus is folded backwards over the body. That is called as a Phrygian cap. That resembles something called as a Phrygian cap. That is an actual cap bone in some. In a particular region of the world, if you just Google it, you will be able to see that it resembles quite resembles this thing. Then, what are the functions of gallbladder? It obviously stores and concentrates the bile 10 times more than the hepatic bile. The mucosa of the gallbladder does not have any gland, so it does not produce any secretion. It only absorbs water because of presence of microvilli over the luminal surface of its lining epithelial cells. And hence it concentrates the bile. It reduces the alkalinity of bile, equalizes the ductal biliary pressure, because the bile is, normally being secreted into the common into the right and left hepatic ducts, then into common hepatic duct, then into common bile duct. Because of closure of a sphincter here, where the common bile duct opens into duodenum, bile cannot enter the duodenum normally, so it fills backwards via the cystic duct into the gallbladder. So it equalizes the ductal biliary pressure. When a fatty meal appears in the duodenum, then the duodenal mucosa releases something called as cholecystokinin. That is going to cause stimulation of contraction of smooth muscle in the wall of gallbladder and relaxation of sphincter, the sphincter of OD at the this hepatopancreatic ampulla, where the CBD and the main pancreatic duct open into the duodenal wall, and so this causes the flow of bile into the duodenum in squirts. And what is the function of bile? Bile contains bile salts, which are important for absorption of the fat by emulsification of the fat by formation of micelles, right? So even though it stores bile, it is not indispensable, because even the surgical removal of this gallbladder, it is not associated with liver dysfunction. It only acts as a concentrating part and a reservoir for the bile. So the only loss of function that will happen by removal of gallbladder is that there will be no reservoir, there will be no reserved bile. When a person eats a fatty meal, his sphincter will relax, and any bile that is present in the bile ducts, that will flow into the duodenum. So a lot of bile cannot be secreted into the duodenum, but only the volume which is present within the bile ducts, that will be you know, flowing into the duodenum. Then we come to the this part that is called as the cystic duct, which connects the neck of the gallbladder to the common hepatic duct. Before that, you can see that the here the gallbladder has been opened up. The lining epithelium or mucosa of the gallbladder gives a honeycomb appearance because of small elevations and depressions formed in it, right? So cystic duct, coming back to cystic duct, so it starts from neck of the gallbladder. It passes in what direction? Now the actual direction would be here. You can see that it is passing downwards, backwards, and slightly towards the left side. So it passes, starts from the neck of gallbladder, passes posteriorly and medially. Medially is towards the left side, often in a tortuous fashion, and that is not in a straight fashion, and it unites with the common hepatic duct to form the common bile duct. It is about 2 to 4 centimeters long. Out of all the extra hepatic biliary passages, it is the narrowest one. The luminal diameter is only 2 millimeter, so it is very important to keep the lumen of this duct patent, that is kept open or patent by these spiral valves, which are formed by crescentic folds of the lining mucosa of the cystic duct. These folds are called as the spiral folds or valves of Hiester. They are, however, not acting as valves. They are just acting to keep the lumen of the cystic duct patent or open. Now, there are, this is the normal anatomy of junction of cystic duct with the common hepatic duct. It unites with the common hepatic duct on its right side at this acute angle of at this very sharp acute angle. However, it can unite with the common hepatic duct in a different manner. Normally, what happens is that cystic duct joins the middle one third. If we, you know, consider the combined length of common hepatic duct plus the common bile duct, normally cystic duct opens somewhere here in the middle one third of the right side of common hepatic duct. But this is the first variation that you can see. This is the cystic duct opening in the distal part of this combined length of common hepatic duct and common bile duct, so that we have a longer common hepatic duct or CHD and a shorter common bile duct, that is the CBD. Remember that CHD and CBD, or common hepatic duct and common bile duct, they are the names given to the same biliary duct. Common hepatic duct is the part of this bile duct proximal to opening of cystic duct, and common bile duct is the name given to the part distal to opening of the cystic duct. So this is the first variation, that cystic duct might open into distal part of the combined lengths of the common hepatic and common bile duct, right? Distal part. Second is that it may drain into a more proximal part. It might open here into the common hepatic duct, or it might open into the right hepatic duct as well, right? That is not shown here, but it might open more proximally. Then it usually joins the right lateral part. This is the left side of common hepatic duct, this is the right side. So it normally joins the right side, but it may drain, it may, you know, wind around the front or the back of the hepatic duct like this thing. Here it is winding around the back, and it is now joining the left side of the common hepatic duct. So it might go pass around its back and open into the left side of common hepatic duct, right? It may pass in front of or behind the common hepatic duct when draining into its left aspect, that we have already talked. Here it is crossing behind the common hepatic duct. It might cross in front of the common hepatic duct as well. Then it can spiral around the common hepatic duct, or it might run parallel to the common hepatic duct within the right free margin of the lesser omentum before joining the common hepatic duct. Sometimes it can open up to the duodenum. It can, you know, run along with the common hepatic duct, not unite with it, and unite with it in a very lower part like this. It is running parallel to this, and there is only little fibrous tissue between the cystic duct and the common hepatic duct. Cystic duct sometimes may be absent, and the neck of bladder is directly opening into common hepatic duct. That is called as a sessile gallbladder. That is, it does not have a cystic duct connecting it to the bile duct. It is directly connected to the bile duct. And then accessory cystic ducts, you know, like this thing, they may arise above the cystic duct, either from the common hepatic duct or the right hepatic duct, and draining this part of gallbladder. Accessory hepatic ducts might drain into the gallbladder, and then the bile might drain via the cystic duct into this thing. So accessory cystic ducts might also be present, multiple cystic ducts. What are the relations of the cystic duct? Now, obviously, it is running from close to the neck of the gallbladder, from anterior to posterior. What are the relations are? The cystic duct is the anteriormost structure, then there is the cystic artery, and then there is the cystic vein. Behind the cystic duct lies the portal vein, medial to it lies the common hepatic vein, and above and this laterally is lying the cystic artery. Now, a very important structure in this area, again that triangular area that we had talked about, it is called, as some people pronounces it, as Callot's triangle. Mostly it is pronounced as Callot's triangle. It is also known as cystohepatic or the hepatobiliary triangle. What are the boundaries of this triangle? If we look here in this diagram, what we have done is that the liver has been it has been pulled upwards, right? And along with it, the gallbladder has been pulled upwards, so that we have exposed the area of lesser omentum, the right free border of lesser omentum, and a window has been cut in the anterior part of the lesser omentum, showing the three structures lying within the right free border. So in this small triangular area, whose boundaries are formed by what? This is the cystic duct going from the neck of the gallbladder and uniting with, this is the common hepatic duct, and they are united to now form the common bile duct. So the inferolateral boundary is formed by the cystic duct. The superolateral boundary is formed by the inferior surface of liver, specifically the segment 5, inferior surface of 5th segment of the liver, and the medial boundary is formed by the common hepatic duct. This triangular area is called as the hepatobiliary triangle, or the cystohepatic triangle, or the Callot's triangle. Earlier, the triangle of Callot or the Callot's triangle did not consider the inferior surface of liver as a boundary, but it considered the cystic artery as a boundary. So this triangle, this small triangle, if I just zoom in, that earlier definition of Callot's triangle was that inferolaterally cystic duct, superolaterally cystic artery, and medially the common hepatic duct. But now that definition has been revised. Sometimes some authors say that Callot's triangle is not the triangle of dissection that you should see. They still consider the boundaries of Callot's triangle as these three: cystic artery, cystic duct, and common hepatic duct. And then they say that the dissection should be done in the hepatobiliary triangle or the cystohepatic triangle, whose boundaries are inferior surface of liver, cystic duct, and the common hepatic duct. But now even the Callot's triangle refers to this hepatobiliary or the cystohepatic triangle. This triangle is important because during cholecystectomy, we need to identify the cystic duct, the common hepatic duct, the cystic artery, and the right hepatic artery all before placing ligatures around the cystic duct and the cystic artery, and before cutting them, so that we do not injure the right hepatic artery or the common hepatic duct or the common bile duct, right? So these are the margins you can see, and this all space is enclosed by a double layer of peritoneum, which acts as a mesentery of the cystic duct, and this is continuous with that right free border of lesser omentum, and upwards it is reaches the porta hepatis. So what are the contents of the Callot's triangle? We obviously know there is the cystic artery lying within it. In addition, there are one or two small cystic veins. We have a cystic lymph node, which we had talked about earlier, draining lymph from the gallbladder. Sometimes accessory hepatic ducts, which drain bile from the liver directly into the gallbladder through the loose areolar tissue. Sometimes those accessory hepatic ducts might arise from this area and then enter the cystic duct or enter into the gallbladder. And it is a very critical area during surgical removal of gallbladder to avoid ligating the common hepatic duct or the common bile duct. So this is a view that you see on laparoscopic cholecystectomy, in which we have introduced the laparoscope into the abdominal cavity. We inflate the abdominal cavity with carbon dioxide to create space within the cavity. Then we introduce a camera into the cavity, and then we introduce these laparoscopic instruments. Here we are looking at the inferior aspect of liver, right? What we can see here is, if I zoom in this thing, and this is the inferior aspect of liver. You can clearly see this is this laparoscopic forceps is holding the gallbladder. This is actually the neck of the gallbladder. Here you can see the cystic duct leading from the neck of the gallbladder. This is a metallic clip placed on the neck of the gallbladder, actually across the cystic duct. This is roughly the junction of the neck of the gallbladder with the cystic duct. So this is the cystic duct. This is the cystic artery. Here you can see, and this was the common bile duct, and this is the line of the common hepatic duct. So common hepatic duct, the cystic duct, and then the inferior aspect of liver. So this is the Calotte's triangle or the hepatobiliary triangle or the cystohepatic triangle. Within it you can clearly see the cystic artery going to supply this whole. This is the body of the gallbladder. Why is it lying upwards? Why is the fundus facing upwards? Because the lower part of liver has been, pulled upwards. So cystic artery lies within the Calotte's triangle, right? Okay, so again, in this diagram we have already talked about, and which was this foramen behind the right margin of lesser omentum, right free margin, that is the epiploic foramen or the foramen of Winslow. Again, a clearer view of the cystohepatic or the Calotte's triangle. Medially or towards the left side is the common hepatic duct, inferolaterally is the cystic duct, and superolaterally is the inferior surface of the liver, specifically the inferior surface of fifth segment of the liver. Then we come to the distal part of the biliary tree of the extrahepatic biliary apparatus, that is the common bile duct, abbreviated as the CBD. This is the longest part. This is roughly 6 to 8 centimeters long, and this is the widest part. Its luminal diameter, your books mention it as 6 to 7 millimeter, but that is the maximum normal value. What is the mean value by a certain study? Its mean value is roughly 3.6 millimeter in people below 60 years of age, and with age the mean diameter increases to a mean of about 4 millimeter after 80 years of age. Up to 7 millimeter the luminal diameter is considered as normal. If it is more than 7 millimeter on ultrasonography, it is called as dilatation of the CBD or dilated CBD, right? Now, how is it found? We know by the union of the cystic duct with the common hepatic duct slightly below the porta hepatis. It has four parts. Now just have a look at these are the two hepatic ducts unite to form the common hepatic duct. This is the cystic duct. You can see that now this is the common bile duct. Here it passes downwards above the duodenum, then it passes behind the duodenum, then in the C shape, within the C shape of duodenum lies the gland called as pancreas. This is the head of pancreas. Somewhere here is the neck of pancreas, and this is called as the body of pancreas. So here it lies in a groove behind the head of the pancreas, and then within the duodenal wall it meets another duct called as the main pancreatic duct. This is the accessory pancreatic duct. This is the main pancreatic duct. The common bile duct and the main pancreatic ducts, they unite within the duodenal wall. Although this is showing the union outside the duodenal wall, the union usually happens within the duodenal wall, and then a common channel, which is usually dilated, that is has a greater diameter, is formed. That is called as the hepatopancreatic ampulla or the ampulla of Vater or ampulla of water, however you want to pronounce it. And then it opens on an elevation on in the mucosa in this medial border of second part of duodenum, that is called as the major duodenal papilla. So what are the parts of the common bile duct? They are, one part is lying above the duodenum, the second part is lying behind the duodenum, third part is lying below the duodenum, and fourth part is lying within the wall of duodenum. So these parts are called as supraduodenal, retroduodenal, infraduodenal, and intraduodenal, that is within the duodenal part. So supraduodenal part obviously passes downwards, backwards, and slightly to the left side within the right free margin of lesser omentum. See, as long as these three structures, that is the common hepatic or the common bile duct, then the proper hepatic artery, and the portal vein, until they reach the upper border of duodenum, they are lying within the right free margin of lesser omentum. After that, and here the relations are, it is forming the anterior boundary of the epiploic foramen, right? Behind is lying the portal vein, and on its left side is lying the proper hepatic artery. If here we see, this is the supraduodenal part of common bile duct. Behind it is lying the portal vein, and on its left side is lying the proper hepatic artery. Behind it is the epiploic foramen, right? Then the retroduodenal part, the part lying behind the duodenum, here it is not visible. Here the duodenum has been shown, this shaded or and dotted part. That means that it is passing behind the first part of duodenum, descends behind first part of duodenum. Relations obviously will be anteriorly, first part of duodenum will be lying posteriorly. Still, the portal vein will be continuing downwards behind this common bile duct. And on the left side, now the gastroduodenal artery will be lying. See, this is the common hepatic artery. Here it gives the right gastric artery. Here it gives the gastroduodenal artery. So, gastroduodenal artery also passes downwards behind the first part of duodenum on the left side of common bile duct. Then we come to the infraduodenal part that lodges in a groove behind the head of pancreas. I have missed an A here. Head of pancreas. Spelling are wrong. And sometimes it passes through the substance of head of pancreas. Usually it lies on the posterior surface of head of pancreas, but it might be embedded totally within the head of pancreas also, right? And what are the relations in front? Obviously, the head of pancreas, the accessory pancreatic duct will also be an anterior relation because the CBD passes behind the accessory pancreatic duct. Then posteriorly, now the inferior vena cava will come in its posterior relations, and where will the portal vein or the superior mesenteric vein come? They will come to its left side. Here the superior mesenteric vein and the splenic vein, they unite behind the neck of pancreas to form the portal vein, which then ascends upwards behind the CBD and in the posterior part of right free margin of lesser omentum. So portal vein or the superior mesenteric vein will come in the left relation of CBD in its infraduodenal part. So no, yes, we know left side, superior mesenteric and portal vein. And the intraduodenal part, as I have already told you, it is 2 cm long, meets the main pancreatic duct in a Y-shaped configuration. See, these are the two limbs of the Y. This is the stem of the Y. To form a common channel about 2 to 10 millimeter long, which has a dilatation, I will show you in subsequent slides. It is called as the hepatopancreatic ampulla of water, which opens on the major duodenal papilla and elevation in the mucosa of medial concave part of second part of duodenum, 8 to 10 centimeter distal to the pylorus. You should know the location of major duodenal papilla. It is where the pylorus ends. If we go 8 to 10 centimeter distal to that, somewhere here you will find the major duodenal papilla, right? So this here is again showing, this is the infraduodenal part of the CBD, and then the intraduodenal part is not visible. With somewhere here these two are uniting, this is the appearance of major duodenal papilla, right? These are the circular folds or walls of Kerkering, which you must have seen today after opening the lumen of intestine. Remember that in the first part of duodenum there are no walls of Kerkering, and this part appears in this barium meal or barium meal follow through x-ray as the duodenal cap. It does not give the regular feathery appearance like the rest of duodenum because of absence of these circular folds or walls of Kerkering, right? So from 8 to 10 centimeter from the pylorus we will find the major duodenal papilla. A couple of centimeters above that you will find the minor duodenal papilla, where the minor pancreatic duct opens. Here the some part of head of pancreas has been removed to show the distalmost part of the this infraduodenal part of CBD and the main pancreatic duct and the accessory pancreatic duct, right? Okay, and this was the supraduodenal part of CBD. The retroduodenal part is again has not been shown, but it passes behind the first part of duodenum. This is the infraduodenal part, and so on. And here you can see this is the common hepatic artery giving the right gastric and the gastroduodenal artery that will form the left relation of retroduodenal part of the CBD. Here it will give the right gastroepiploic artery and will give the superior pancreaticoduodenal artery, which divides into anterior and posterior parts. The posterior one is also going to supply this part of CBD, right? And on the left side, the relation will be the superior mesenteric vein, which will unite with the splenic vein to form somewhere here the portal vein behind the neck of pancreas. Then again, showing this is the cystic duct, the common hepatic duct, the common bile duct, the supraduodenal part, retroduodenal part. Here you can see it is going behind the this part of duodenum, infraduodenal part, and then finally the intraduodenal part unites with the main pancreatic duct. And this is the ampulla of water, the dilated part or the hepatopancreatic ampulla. And that is now the distalmost part of the common bile duct is also surrounded by a sphincter. Main pancreatic duct is also surrounded by a sphincter, and the hepatopancreatic ampulla also has a sphincter. So there are three sphincters present in this region. We will see that later. And this is a magnified view of interior aspect of the second part of duodenum. This is the major duodenal papilla, right? And it is usually marked by these longitudinal folds about 8 to 10 centimeter distal to the pylorus. And roughly two centimeter above it lies the minor duodenal papilla, where what opens is the accessory pancreatic duct, right? So here the sphincters are shown. This is the sphincter cholecystocus. It is also called as the sphincter of Biden. This is the sphincter pancreaticus, which surrounds the distal part of the main pancreatic duct. And this is the ampulla of, this one is ampulla of Vater, and this sphincter is called as the sphincter of Oddi proper. These three sphincters together are also called as the sphincter of Oddi or sphincter of Oddi, whichever way you want to pronounce it. But this sphincter surrounding the hepatopancreatic ampulla is called as the sphincter of Oddi proper, right? And this is the strongest one and the most frequently present. This one, sphincter pancreaticus, may be present, may not be present. This one is also present usually, right? Then sphincter of Biden is the strongest one. Usually how much pressure is there within by the contraction of gallbladder, that is roughly measures as 25 centimeter column of water, right? And this sphincter provides a resistance of 20 centimeter of water. So normally the pressure in the biliary passages is lower than that when the gallbladder is resting and not contracting. But when a fatty meal reaches the duodenum, then the gallbladder contracts because of cholecystokinin release from the duodenal mucosa. Then the pressure will be 25, but the sphincter whose pressure is maximum is 20 centimeter of water, and by cholecystokinin the sphincter relaxes also. So then the bile will flow, as well as the pancreatic juice that will flow into the lumen of the duodenum, right? You do not have to focus on these reinforcing fibers and all. You just, this diagram is just to show you the circular muscle fibers surrounding the distal part of CBD, circular muscle fibers surrounding the distal part of main pancreatic duct, and circular muscle fibers surrounding the hepatopancreatic ampulla. Then the blood supply of CBD, as I've already told you, upper part, that is the supraduodenal part, is supplied by cystic artery, might receive twigs from the right hepatic artery. Lowest part, that is the infraduodenal part and the intraduodenal part, it is supplied partly by the posterior superior pancreaticoduodenal artery, which is a branch of gastroduodenal artery, which is further a branch of common hepatic, which is a branch of celiac trunk. So the artery of foregut is supplying, whereas it anastomoses with the posterior inferior pancreaticoduodenal artery, which is a branch of superior mesenteric artery or the artery of the midgut, at the level of ampulla of water. So if the anastomosis between the two is poor, then the ligation of posterior superior pancreaticoduodenal artery may cause avascular necrosis of the distal common bile duct. Avascular necrosis means death of tissue because of loss of vascularity or loss of blood supply, right? Then how can we visualize the gallbladder in earlier times? What an investigation used to be done, that was called as cholecystography, either oral or intravenous cholecystography. What was it? That certain radio opaque dyes like sodium tetraiodophenophthalene they were given per orally, that is either by mouth, patient was asked to swallow that dye, a solution of that dye, or intravenously, it was injected in a vein, right, in a different formulation but the same compound, so that it does not cause any irritation within the vein. So either by per oral pathway or by intravenous route, the dye was given, and these dyes are such that they are metabolized and excreted in the bile by the liver. So they will go in the common hepatic ducts, then till the sphincter is closed, they will be stored in the gallbladder, they will be concentrated there. So they collect in the gallbladder, and then after a certain amount of time after swallowing or the intravenous injection, if we take an X-ray of the right upper quadrant of the patient, we will be able to see the gallbladder if it is functioning normally and if the cystic duct and the rest of the biliary passage is normal. If the gallbladder is not functioning or its neck has a stone impacted in it so that bile cannot enter the gallbladder, in that case it is called as a non-functioning gallbladder, and then the gallbladder would not be visualized, right? So, however, now this investigation need not be done anymore because on ultrasonography we can very easily visualize, since the gallbladder is lying so close to the anterior abdominal wall, the gallbladder can be very beautifully recognized. Here you can see the anterior wall of the gallbladder, posterior wall of gallbladder, the neck of the gallbladder, cystic duct can be seen, portal vein can be seen, the liver can be seen. So ultrasonography is the investigation of choice for visualizing the gallbladder. If we suspect the patient has inflammation of gallbladder, that is cholecystitis, or stones within the gallbladder, that is called as cholelithiasis, then ultrasonography is the first investigation that we do, right, and has been practically replaced by ultrasonography. Now we come to the applied anatomy of this extrahepatic biliary apparatus. One is that, as I've already talked about, that inflammation of the gallbladder is called as cholecystitis. It could be acute, it could be chronic. The most common cause of inflammation of the gallbladder is impaction of a gallstone. Now, gallstones are usually formed of cholesterol. Because of high concentration of cholesterol within the bile, stones start forming around concretions. They might be formed of bile salts or calcium salts as well, but most commonly they are formed of cholesterol, right? In 50% of people, there might be stones within the gallbladder, but they do not cause any symptoms. So the patient does not feel any pain or, any discomfort. A gallstone has to be large enough to cause either mechanical damage to the wall of gallbladder or a blockage in the cystic duct or the common hepatic duct or the common bile duct. Right, so only if it is causing a mechanical damage to the gallbladder or it is causing a blockage in the pathway in the flow of bile, only then it is going to cause problems, right? For example, in the Hartmann's pouch, if a gallstone is lodged there and it blocks the drainage of bile from gallbladder into the this if we come back to that diagram, if a gallstone is lodged here, a big one, so that no bile can enter via the cystic duct when this ampulla is closed, and when fatty meal comes here and cholecystokinin tells the gallbladder to contract and empty the bile contents. If from earlier any bile content was present within the gallbladder and now it contracts, but this stone will not let any content to pass from gallbladder to here, then the inflammation is going to begin in the gallbladder. That is going to we cause problems. So on in a short term, short duration problem is called as acute cholecystitis. If it has been present for a long time, that is called as chronic cholecystitis, basically. And so cholecystitis is common in fat, fertile females over 40 years of age. This is the most common demographic group in which cholecystitis is present, right? Sometimes gallstones, not sometimes, a lot of times the gallstones, that is with the technical term for that is cholelithiasis, they are associated with cholecystitis. So Gall bladder needs to be removed only if the gall stones are causing cholecystitis. They are causing inflammation, they are causing pain in the patient. Otherwise, asymptomatic case of cholelithiasis does not need cholecystitis, does not need cholecystectomy. That is, we do not need to remove the gallbladder if there are stones, but they are not causing any symptoms in the patient. You know, sometimes gallstones might be detected on an ultrasound of the upper abdomen for some other reason. Ultrasound has been done for some other reason, but the sonologist sees that the gallbladder has some stones in it. But if he asks the patient that there is no pain in the right upper quadrant, then the gallstones are not causing any problem, then the gallbladder does not need to be removed. Right. Now, small gallstones, if dislodged from the gallbladder, can cause stretching pain while passing through the neck of the gallbladder or the cystic duct or the CVD. That is called as biliary cholecystitis. If this happens in the patient, then we need to remove the gallbladder. Sometimes a dislodged stone from gallbladder might travel all the way down to the ampulla of Vater. That the gallstone, they were formed here, they have traveled through the cystic duct, through the common bile duct, and here, the narrowest part of the biliary passage, here it has stuck and it is not letting either the bile or the pancreatic juice to flow into the duodenum. Then that causes something called as the obstructive jaundice. It can also cause pancreatitis, because then what will happen is the bile will not flow here, but because the pancreatic sphincter is comparatively weaker or sometimes absent, the bile can flow backwards into the pancreas, right? Sometimes, so it may cause inflammation of the pancreas, or that is called as pancreatitis. And the stasis of bile here can cause the biliary colic, that where the wall of this common bile duct will be stretched, right? So that is going to cause obstructive jaundice. Jaundice is what? Yellowing of the skin because of increased levels of bilirubin within the blood. In the skin, in which skin, sclera of eye, exposed parts of mucous membrane are turned yellow when there is a level of bilirubin more than 2 mg/dL. Right? So why is it called obstructive? Because there is an obstruction to the flow of bile because of lodging of a stone here. Right? But another reason of CBD obstruction can be the malignant growth of head of pancreas. See, here in this part, it is related to head of pancreas. If there is cancer of the head of pancreas, malignant growth of head of pancreas, then that might compress this part of the infraduodenal part of CBD from outside, compress it, so impede the flow of bile from within it into the major duodenal papilla. That can also cause obstructive jaundice. So there is a difference between these two conditions, jaundice because of these two conditions. What is the difference is that if it is happening because of a gallstone, then the gallstones have been, they were first formed in the gallbladder, then later in passed through the cystic duct. So the inflammation of gallbladder would have been present for a long time, chronic inflammation. In that case, the wall of the gallbladder is fibrosed and the gallbladder itself has shrunk because of that fibrosis, and so gallbladder is small in size and cannot be palpated in the patient. If we try to feel the gallbladder through the anterior abdominal wall, we won't be able to feel it, and even on ultrasound we will be able to see that the gallbladder is very small in size. Whereas, and the second thing is that the obstruction is intermittent. Why intermittent? Because that stone might sometimes move a bit and let the accumulated bile accumulated behind it to sometimes pass into the duodenum. So the obstruction might be relieved for some time, and then after some time again the stone moves further distally, gets blocked again. So the obstruction is intermittent. It is released for some time and then the obstruction resumes. So that is intermittent. The jaundice might be relieved for some time and then again jaundice might happen. So the obstruction is intermittent. Whereas in case of obstruction because of the malignant growth of head of pancreas, the obstruction and hence the jaundice is progressive. That is, it keeps on increasing. There is no relief in the obstruction. It is very progressive. It only keeps on increasing. and it is associated with a distended and hence palpable gallbladder. So the gallbladder will be palpable, might be palpable in the patient, and on ultrasonography you will be able to see that the size of gallbladder is increased. This is called as Courvoisier's law. That is, in a patient with frequent, in a patient of jaundice, if the gallbladder is small and fibrotic, then that jaundice, obstructive jaundice, is because of a gallstone. Whereas if the gallbladder is enlarged and palpable, there are more chances that it is because of a malignant growth in the head of pancreas. Even though it is not 100% conclusive, but it guides us towards the diagnosis. Right? Now, when the bile duct is blocked, the liver is unable to secrete bile sometimes in the later stages because of increased pressure within the duct system, and the patient is deeply jaundiced, but the duct is filled with mucus by the continued secretion of mucus gland. That condition is called as white bile. Jaundice we have already talked. Right. Now, about that thing, that in cholecystectomy, what is done is one ligature or metallic clip is placed on this end. Another ligature, preferably two ligatures or two clips, are placed on this end, and then the cystic duct is cut in between the two. Why two are placed on this side? To be double sure that after the surgery, sometimes this ligature might slip. So there should be another, ligature here. So just in case this one slips, still there is another ligature holding the stump of cystic duct closed, so that bile coming from the still, which is coming from the liver, does not flow out into the peritoneal cavity. Because if bile comes into peritoneal cavity, that is going to cause chemical irritation and later peritonitis. We do not want that to happen. Why is only a single ligature placed here? Because eventually during the surgery, this part is going to be removed. So there is no risk of, removal slipping of this ligature later on, because this part will be removed. Same goes for cystic artery. One ligature is placed to on the cystic end, and two ligatures are placed towards this common hepatic or the right hepatic artery. Here it is shown to be a branch of the this proper hepatic artery, but most commonly it is a branch of the right hepatic artery. So two ligatures are placed here and the cystic artery is cut. Why is it important to identify all the four structures, that is common hepatic duct, cystic duct, proper hepatic artery, right hepatic artery, and the cystic artery, before placing these ligatures and cutting these structures? Suppose, for example, while dissection, if you have the length of cystic duct is very small, and you have mistakenly identified this part, the common bile duct and the common hepatic duct, as the cystic duct, suppose you end up placing the ligatures here, and you cut in between the two. What is going to happen eventually? That the bile is going to leak from this part, and the bile is not going to flow eventually into the duodenum. So total obstructive jaundice will be produced in the patient, right? We do not want that to happen. Similarly here, if you misidentify the right hepatic artery as the cystic artery, and you place a ligature here and cut it in between the two, what is going to happen is you will remove the gallbladder. Okay, fine. But the blood supply via hepatic artery to the right functional lobe of liver will be totally lost. We do not want that to happen either. So before placing ligatures, it is very important for the surgeon to identify cystic artery, okay, cystic duct, okay, but you also identify which one is the right hepatic artery and which one is the common hepatic and common bile duct, so that we can be doubly sure that we are staying away from these structures. We do not want to injure these structures. We want to ligate and cut only the cystic duct and the cystic artery. So that is the important point during cholecystectomy. Another couple of points about applied anatomy are, again, we have already talked about this thing, that 50% of people are asymptomatic, and over a 20-year period of time, more than two-thirds of people will remain symptom-free. And the longer the stones do not cause any symptoms, the less likely are they to cause any symptoms at all, right? So it should be large enough. Gallstone should be large enough to produce. We have already talked about this. Cholecystitis we have done. Hartmann's pouch we have done. Then this thing, if a peptic duodenal ulcer ruptures, this is the first part of duodenum. So suppose there is an ulceration in this part of duodenum. It ruptures. It might rupture through the posterior wall of gallbladder as well, creating an opening between the gallbladder and the duodenum. That is called as a cholecystectomic fistula. One, it might be because of peptic ulceration. Second, it might be because of a chronic cholecystitis as well, because there is occurring of fibrosis and eventually there might be erosion of the wall of gallbladder. And behind wall of gallbladder lies either the first or second part of duodenum. So the fibrosis might erode through the gallbladder into the duodenum. So this cholecystoenteric fistula is created. Via this fistula, a gallstone, a large gallstone, which normally would not have been able to enter the cystic duct, when the gallbladder contracts, it might enter the duodenum. Via the duodenum, it might travel distally via jejunum ileum. It might reach and go and reach some part of ileum and get stuck there, because the diameter of luminal diameter of ileum is very small. So it might cause paralysis of ileum. That is called as the gallstone ileus, right? And gallbladder, which is dilated and inflamed owing to an impacted gallstone in its duct, may develop adhesions with the adjacent viscera as well, and continued inflammation may break down or ulcerate the tissue boundaries here. Not by fibrosis, but because of formation of adhesions between the adjacent viscera. Those are basically but formation of fibrosis only. So between the gallbladder and a part of the gastrointestinal tract adherent to it, resulting in a cholecystoenteric fistula. Because of their proximity to gallbladder, the superior part of duodenum, that is first part of duodenum, and the transverse colon are most likely to develop a fistula of this type. Fistula would enable a large gallstone incapable of passing through the cystic duct to enter the gastrointestinal tract. A large gallstone entering the small intestine in this way may become trapped at the ileocecal valve, producing a bowel obstruction and or later on paralysis as well because of irritation, gallstone ileus. So a cholecystoenteric fistula also permits, see, the small intestine and the large intestine, they are filled with gas-producing microorganisms, bacteria, so that enteric gas might enter the gallbladder, and via cystic duct, it might enter the common hepatic duct and the intrahepatic biliary passages as well, right? That condition is called as pneumobilia. Pneumobilia can also be produced by certain other procedures or conditions. We will talk about that also. Pneumobilia should be differentiated from, so pneumobilia is air within the biliary passages. There might be presence of air within the portal venous system as well. Both will be seen as air within the liver during the radiographic imaging of the upper abdomen. So air within liver should be differentiated whether it is air within the biliary passages or is it air within the portal venous system. Air within portal venous system is a much more serious condition. Another applied thing, a very important thing, is ERCP or endoscopic retrograde cholangiopancreatography. What is done is that a fiber optic endoscope is introduced through the mouth of the patient via esophagus, via the stomach, via the duodenum. Now, when it has reached the duodenum, there is a little camera here on the medial side of the endoscope. Via that camera, you can visualize the major duodenal papilla. There is a very small catheter then that can be protruded out. It can be, threaded into the major duodenal papilla. Then, under live X-ray, that is called as fluoroscopy, under fluoroscopic guidance, the catheter can be put in either into the main common bile duct or into the main pancreatic duct, or it can be just kept here and then a radiopaque dye is injected. So if the catheter is kept here, then the dye will go into both the biliary and the pancreatic passages. If it is kept here, then it will go only in the biliary passage. If it is kept here, then it will go into the pancreatic passages. And so all the biliary tree or the pancreatic duct system can be visualized. So this is an actual visualization. Under a live fluoroscopy, you can see these lower thoracic and upper lumbar vertebrae. This is the actual fiber optic endoscope that is passing through the esophagus. This part is passing through the stomach. This part is passing through the duodenum. Then you can see that the small catheter has come from the medial aspect of the fiber optic endoscope, and here the dye has been injected. This dye is lying within the main pancreatic duct. It is outlined like this, and here it is filling the common bile duct, the left hepatic duct, and the right hepatic duct, and here you can see the tortuous cystic duct, and then it is going into the gallbladder. If suppose there is a stone lying here, then no dye will be able to go beyond it, and this part of the tree will not be visualized. So if proximal part of tree is not visualized, then we know that either there is a stone here, which will be seen as a filling defect, or there is a constriction here, which that then we have to identify with further investigations. Here also you can see this is the second part of duodenum. The endoscope has been introduced and this catheter is introduced. Over this catheter we can either thread over a stent, which can keep before putting in a stent, what we do is we introduce a balloon. Suppose this part of the CBD was constricted. We inflate that balloon, we dilate this part of the CBD, and then we place in a stent so that it keeps this part of the CBD patent, does not let it collapse again, right? Then there is another thing called a sphincterotomy. The major duodenal papilla and the sphincter of OD, it is cut slightly because sometimes a large stone is lodged here, which otherwise could not have been delivered into the duodenum and then taken out via this endoscope. But by cutting the sphincter, then this the stone lodged here can be taken out. Now, in this condition, if we have done a sphincterotomy, then later on the duodenal contents might be pushed back in a retrograde fashion into the biliary passages. The gas, duodenal gas, might enter this thing that is again called as pneumobilia, right? So several things can happen. Then there is something called as the Merezi syndrome, that is obstruction of common hepatic duct because of either inflammation caused by a stone here or directly by a stone lodged in the neck of the gallbladder. Comparatively a rare phenomenon, right? And so that's all about this lecture. Thank you.